you know, should baptism with water, should it be by immersion or should it be by sprinkling? You know, I originally went, when I first got saved, I was going to a Bible Presbyterian church, and they do not baptize you with water by immersion. They just, you know, put a handful of water on your head and call that baptism. Now, I do not believe that is scriptural baptism. I believe that's wrong. But let me show you a couple of verses of why we baptize by immersion, why you go underwater and not just sprinkled with some water on your head. Colossians 2, verse 12. But we already read in Romans 6 where it says we are buried with him by baptism into death. So the burial there, we see it again in Colossians 2. We are buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God who has raised him from the dead. So we see here that we are buried with him in baptism. You know, the Holy Ghost buries us with Jesus Christ into his death, and that's what the water baptism is meant to represent. So that's why we go under the water, because when you bury a dead body, you don't just put the dead body there and then put a handful of dirt on it, right? When you bury a dead body, that's going to freak a lot of people out if that's what you did. So when you bury a dead body, I mean, you cover it and you fully immerse it with dirt, don't you? And that's why we are immersed with water. We're not just sprinkled with water. You know, my preference as well is that's why I believe baptism should be a person being laid backwards this way, right, into the water. Why? Because it's symbolic of burial. You know, I believe that's how you bury people, right? You don't bury people face down, and you don't bury people standing up. Oh, I don't know, unless the graveyard is limited in space, right? Maybe you'll bury them standing up. But, you know, we bury them lying down because it's meant to represent them sleeping, right? And one day they're going to rise in Jesus Christ. And that's why when people get baptized, they are bent over backwards into the water, because it's representing burying them in that water. So whilst I don't think it invalidates baptism, you know, I don't believe baptism should be somebody going this way or somebody going this way. And you see that in a lot of the Jesus movies, don't you? You see John the Baptist, he's like, John the Baptist, he's not even paying attention to the people baptizing. He's like preaching and they're coming and he's just like, but you know, he's not, that's not, I don't think that's how baptism should be done. I personally think baptism should be done, you know, facing back, going backwards, so that it represents that burial. But you know, you wonder if baptism by immersion is so clear in the Bible, you know, how do the proponents of baptism by sprinkling even support that doctrine? How do they even support, you know, being sprinkled with water? Well, I believe that there's two ways they try and justify it. You know, one is the sprinkling of blood in the Old Testament. So they say, oh, you know, there is this, you know, because most Protestant and Catholics sprinkle, you know, they're the ones that are thinking that baptism saves you, right? So they think that, you know, the sprinkling of blood in the Old Testament cleanses sin. And that's why in the New Testament, we're going to sprinkle with our holy water. We're going to sprinkle with water because that's cleansing them from sin. So I think that's one way they try and justify this sprinkling of water, because I remember asking my Bible Presbyterian bishop, you know, why do we sprinkle and why do we not immerse? And these are the two reasons he gave. So one was, you know, there is sprinkling in the Bible, so that's why they sprinkle with water, because of the sprinkling of blood. But remember, baptism represents the death, doesn't it? It doesn't represent the cleansing of sin. It represents the burial. So it doesn't have that symbolism there if you sprinkle. But the other reason he gave me? The other reason was, well, we see paintings of church fathers of them being sprinkled. And it's like, wow, well, that's a really solid argument for why you sprinkle, because of church fathers. And I remember him telling me that it was really funny, because he was saying, you know, these old paintings and these old pictures of the church fathers baptizing people with sprinkling. And he told me that there are these paintings of two people standing in water and then a person sprinkling him, you know, on water. And I was just thinking, well, if you're both gonna stand in a body of water, why not just immerse him? Why stand in a body of water just to sprinkle somebody? You know, you can do that out of a body of water. I mean, I've never seen this painting, but I just remember him telling me that, that, you know, because I would say to him, Well, both Philip and the eunuch went into the water and he baptized him. And he was like, oh yeah, but there's paintings of them both standing in water. And, you know, Philip might have just put water on his head. So those are the only two reasons. If you guys know any other reasons why they try and justify sprinkling, I haven't heard of them. They're the only two I could come up with. But let's just look at a couple of other verses that support being baptized with water by immersion. Look at the baptism of the Holy Ghost that happened on the day of Pentecost. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and look, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. So when the Holy Ghost came to baptize those first believers, when the baptism of the Holy Ghost started, because one question you might have is, well, if every believer is baptized by the Holy Ghost, why then are these believers in the New Testament baptized after they're saved? Well, just like the indwelling of the Holy Ghost was after those initial believers were saved, I think there was a point in time where that baptism and that indwelling of the Holy Ghost started, and they obviously existed at a time where they were saved before that point. But then when the baptism came, it manifested itself in signs and wonders. But now every believer is baptized into the body of Jesus Christ. But we see there the baptism of the Holy Ghost, when it actually happened, it filled the house. Right? It didn't just sprinkle them with a little bit of Holy Ghost. I mean, it filled the house and immersed them in the Spirit. And that's why we should baptize by immersion. Another point to support baptism by immersion says here in John 3, and John also was baptizing in Anon near to Salem because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. So why does the Bible bother to tell us that John baptized in an area that had a lot of water? If he baptized by sprinkling, he didn't need to be in the Jordan River or near where a lot of water was. He could have just carried a bottle of water with him in order to sprinkle people with. So there was much water there. So I think that supports baptism by immersion. I already sort of covered this one, but I'll just go here again. And Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, talking to the Ethiopian eunuch. And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. So I already sort of covered that, but just again, you know, if baptism was by immersion, why didn't Philip just get out of the chariot and go get some water and then baptize him at the chariot? No, he went to the trouble to take the eunuch out of the chariot. They both went into the water and he baptized him, because baptism is by immersion. It wouldn't make sense if it was by sprinkling. And we went here before. I'll just read verse 16 from Matthew 3. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. Now, I do believe Jesus Christ himself was baptized by immersion for all the other reasons that we give. I found that, you know, I could never fully use this verse just to prove that Jesus was baptized by immersion, because one way it was explained to me once was, you know, Jesus, when he was baptized, he then just got out of the water. Like, instead of like when he came up straightway out of the water, talking about him coming up out of the water, some people have tried to explain that to say, well, he was baptized in the water and then straightway he got out of the water, and that's when the Spirit descended on him, and John said, you know, the voice said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Because this is how the sprinklers try to justify, well, he was in the water, but they just sprinkled on his head, you know, like the church paintings, and then he just got out of the water. So that they'll say, well, that's not saying that he came up out of the water, which is what we believe. It's just saying that he stepped out of the water. And I think they try and say that with the Ethiopian eunuch as well, like, you know, after they came out of the water, they were just both standing in there being baptized by sprinkling. But you know what's funny? Because, you know, most of the churches that even teach sprinkling, they acknowledge that Jesus Christ was baptized by immersion. Because I remember when I used to go to this Bible Presbyterian church and we heard a sermon on baptism by immersion versus baptism by sprinkling. And you know what's so funny? Because they get up And one point in his sermon was all the different ways that the church fathers, you know, just basically mean old Christians that, you know, in the past were baptized. And he went through different examples saying like, oh, you know, John Wesley, and I might not get these right, but just for illustration's sake, you know, John Wesley, he was sprinkled, and yeah, and this, you know, John Calvin, he was in a bathtub. And so he went through all these different examples of different people and how they were baptized. But then one of his examples was, you know, our Lord Jesus, he was immersed. But then his conclusion was, well, you see, it doesn't matter whether you're sprinkled or immersed, because different people were immersed and sprinkled different ways. But to me, it's like, what if Jesus did one thing one way? Why wouldn't you do it that way? Why would you know? Why would you acknowledge that Jesus Christ himself was immersed, but yet you're going to sprinkle? You know, that does not make sense to me at all. You know, so they admit that Jesus Christ was immersed. And you know, they have these really funny sayings, people that sprinkle. They have these cute little sayings to just, you know, give them, I guess, I don't know, encourage them in their doctrine, right, of sprinkling. One thing he used to say was, water more or less, gospel is the best. Water more or less, gospel. You know, how about water more or less? The truth is the best. That's why you use more water, right? You know, the gospel is the best. It's the death, burial, and resurrection. And that's why more water is required to symbolize the gospel than just sprinkling. But you know the other thing that they used to say? They used to say, more water, less faith. Less water, more faith. And I remember this guy who was a Baptist in our church at the time, he was like really offended at that saying. But you know, maybe they're right. Right? Maybe they're right that less water, more faith, because you need to have a lot of faith to go against what the Bible's saying, right? The Bible's saying you're immersed, you're buried with him in baptism, but they're going to believe contrary to that and then sprinkle. So maybe if you use less water, you do have more faith, because I think it takes less faith to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ.